all I have used you. I have to take the microphone.
You need to put that on.
This is the microphone. We start with the microphone. Okay. Is the microphone working?
I have to go turn it off.
He's going to turn it
off. Yes, better than nothing.
Okay.
And to go ahead, which one? Okay.
Look at that.
Good.
Is the microphone on?
Is the microphone on? Yes. Okay. Because I have to stay here because I have to the necessity to read. Because I know that my English is not good. Usually I beg the pardon of people telling, I know that my English is not good, but I know also that your Italian is not better than my English. So we have no other possibility than continue in English. So the 20th century and the beginning of the new century saw the flourishing of numerous studies concerning the development of Christian iconography of the early centuries and its role in the transmission of faith. The rediscovery of the Christian icon of the first millennium also coincides with the period of the beginning of the scientific studies applied to the shroud, with the famous first photograph of the linen taken by Secondo Pia in May 1898. Yeah, you see the photograph, positive and negative, of Secondo Pia. In the beginning of the 20th century, Professor Paul Vignon, a philosopher and scientist, highlighted the close relationship between the shroud and the depiction of the face of Christ from the 4th century onwards. The observation of the similarity between the shroud face and most of the depiction of Christ known in art, both Eastern and Western, together with the study of sources referring to such images, shows a clear dependence. The evident similarity cannot be attributed to a poor case, but it seems to be the result of a correlation, mediated or immediate, of any image from the other and of all from a common source. Paul Vignon agreed that Christ's face, as presented in Christian art, was elaborated and modeled from the shroud face, and he also felt that there was a similarity between the classic type of Christ face with the bird and the faint image impressed on the shroud. Observing the face of the man of the shroud, in fact, it is possible to identify many elements of irregularity that are repeated in the painted images of Christ. These are not simply attributable to the imagination of the artist. They also allow us to hypothesize with a high degree of certainty that the ancient depiction of Christ's face depend on the venerated relic. Analyzing the pictorial reproduction, Vignon was the first to note and highlight some coincidence with the shroud face later referred to as Vignon points. The hair is long and bipartite. Sometimes two or three locks of hair in the middle of the forehead are present, and this detail could be a pictorial interpretation of the trickle of blood in an epsilon shape visible in the center of the forehead of the shroud face. The superciliary arches are pronounced, and in some of these representations, an eyebrow appears higher than the other, like in the shroud face. At the root of the nose, some portraits show a sign that resembles a square missing its upper edge, and below it, there is a V sign. The nose is long and straight, and the eyes are big and deep, wide open, with enormous irises and big eye sockets. The cheekbones are very pronounced, sometimes with the spots. In some pictures, it is noted just on the shroud, a quite large area without imprint between the cheeks and the hair, so that the locks of hair appear strongly detached from the face. One of the cheeks of the man of the shroud is very swollen, probably because of a severe trauma, and the asymmetry of the face is evident. In the lower part of it, at the height of the maxillary bones, there are significant similarities between the shroud face and the representation of Jesus Christ. The moustaches that are often drooping are disposed asymmetrically and descend beyond the lips on each side with a different angle. The mouth is small, not hidden by the moustache. The beard, not too long, bipartite and sometimes tripartite, is slightly moved on one side. There is a beardless area under the lower lip. The inspiration from the shroud is evident, for example, in the signs between the eyebrows on the forehead and on the right cheek on Christ's face, 8th century, fresco of the catacombs of Pontianus in Rome. You see this square and this sign on the cheekbone. In the light of this evident correspondence, it turns out indispensable to search through history the documents, the mentions, the descriptions of this particular object, the shroud, to understand how much it could have influenced the representation of Christ during the centuries. It is known that the New Testament does not hand down any description of the Savior's physical features. The prohibitions of the Old Law probably appeared to be an obstacle for the nascent church and an impediment to fixing the physiognomy in pictorial portraits or statues, although the legend attributed some of them to St. Luke or Nicodemus, therefore at the apostolic time. Until the 4th century, symbolic representations of Christ, lamb, bread, fish, are imposed along with the use of appearances derived from other religions, Christ the Son, Good Shepherd, Orpheus, Hercules, Thaumaturge, Master, Philosopher. In many cases, the representation of the young and beardless Christ is used to emphasize his divine nature. After the freedom of worship granted by Constantine to Christianity and sanctioned in 313 by the so-called Milan Edict, a different image of Jesus' face started to spread, characterized by a beard that was not too long, moustache, a high and majestic appearance, long hair that fall on the shoulders and that sometimes show a central line that divides them. One of the first depictions of the bearded Christ appears in Rome in the Hypogeum of the Aureli, 3rd century. Among the works that show him with the beard, we must remember some sarcophagi of Theodosian age, 4th century, still preserved, for example, in the Vatican Museums, in San Sebastian outside the walls in Rome, in Sant'Ambrogio in Milan, and the Lapidari Museum of Arles. Other examples of Christ's depiction that show a striking resemblance to the shroud face. Note the age 4th century, 5th century, so very old. Also, the ancient icon on panel called Acheropita of the Most Holy Savior, venerated in the oratory of San Lawrence in Palazzo, called Sancta Sanctorum in Rome, although in its stylistic simplicity, shows schematically this similarity. The original icon, completely deteriorated, goes back to the 5th, 6th century. The mosaic of the chapel of St. Venantius by the Baptistery of St. John Lateran, 7th century, shows a bust of Christ of that kind. This is one of the most well-preserved ancient mosaics in Rome, 7th century, can you imagine? Another example is the mosaic of the apse of the Basilica of St. John Lateran, 13th century. Other remarkable example, 13th century, 12th century. Starting from the 6th century, a particular type of portrait of Jesus that seems to be inspired by the shroud spreads also in the East. It is the majestic Christ with a beard and moustache called the Pantocrator, the creator of all things, which will be called the Almighty in the West, of which there are some ancient examples in the rock churches of Cappadocia. There is a rather evident inspiration from the shroud also in the face of Christ on the silver vase of the 6th century found in Homs, Syria, now in the Louvre in Paris, and in the one visible on the silver reliquary of 550 coming from Cherson in Crimea, which is in the Hermitage in St. Petersburg. The Pantocrator is also present in the post-Byzantine era, and it will remain substantially unchanged until today. This way of representing Christ has become the only one in the first Christian millennium, both in the East and the West. Even with the beginning of the new Christian millennium, things in the East do not change. In the Pantocrator, 13th century, of the Basilica of Hagia Sophia in Constantinople, and in the Pantocrator, 14th century, in the Church of San Savior in Cora, in Constantinople, as well, you can notice concave cheeks and prominent and asymmetric cheekbones. A distinctive and original sign is the detail in the middle of the forehead. It is present frequently. It can be a singular or double strand of hair, sometimes even a vertical wrinkle. It is always painted in the center of the foreheads and reveals, although in different interpretation, the shroud origin, the characteristic trickle of blood on the forehead. You can notice the lock of hair, simple or double, for example, in the mosaic of the apsidal vault in the oratory of St. Laurent in Palazzo in Rome, which depicts Christ Pantocrator in a clypeus. 9th century, in the Pantocrator, 12th century of Cefalù Cathedral in Palermo, in the Pantocrator, 12th century of Monreale Cathedral in Palermo, in the Pantocrator, 12th century of Sant'Angelo in Formis Church in Capua, Caserta, in the Pantocrator, 12th century of the Church of Daphne Monastery near Athens. The detail appears instead like a true and proper trickle of blood in the forehead of Christ on the crucifixion panel in one of the windows of the portal of the kings in Chartres Cathedral, 12th century. The observation of the shroud face seems to have influenced also the representation of Christ on the Byzantine coins from the 7th century. Justinian II, the Byzantine emperor, was the first emperor to have the face of Jesus to be represented on coins. On his golden solidus, there is a Pantocrator whose features are very similar to those of the shroud. Wavy hair falling behind the shoulders, long beard, moustache, and the characteristic little tuft on the forehead. Unfortunately, there are very few images of Christ that survived the terrible period of iconoclasm, which, denying the legality of images in Christianity, destroyed much of the existing ones. When the iconoclast struggles ceased, the face of Christ, similar to the shroud, was portrayed again on coins. The strongly inspired by the shroud Pantocrator, expressive with the large eyes, long hair, and beard, appears on the golden solidus of Mile III. The golden solidus of Basil I, another Byzantine emperor, is the first coin coined with the figure of Christ on the throne. The face has many characteristics of the shroud. With the technique of a superimposition in polarized light, it has been shown that the shroud face fits in most points with that suitable enlarged of the Pantocrator portrayed on coins. There are more than 140 highlighted points of congruence, which are the points of overlap with the solidus and with the tremissis of the first reign of Justinian II. Those correspondences widely satisfy the American forensic criterion, according to which from 45 to 60 points of congruence are enough to establish the identity or similarity of two images. The same technique was applied to one of the finest examples of Pantocrator, the icon of the monastery of San Caterina at Mount Sinai, 6th century, which has even 250 points of congruence. Another comparison of the shroud face was made with the technique of digital processing. It turned out that the traits and the outlines of the shroud face are superimposable to those of the Christ of the icon of the Sinai. It is interesting to notice that the wooden doors of the Basilica of San Sabina in Rome, 5th century, present Christ without a beard in all the scenes of his life. But Christ with a beard in the scenes of the Passion. This distinction also characterizes the mosaics of St. Apollinaris New in Ravenna, 6th century. The hypothesis that there may be a reason to relate the representation of the bird Christ with the Passion seems more than plausible, and it is referable to a pre-existing image clearly linked to the moments of Jesus' suffering. The reference to the shroud and to the testimonies, both written and iconographic, of an imprint left by Jesus on a cloth with his sweat and his blood does not seem unbelievable at all. All the literary references that report legends and tradition, as well as the simple hints of the evidence of such an image, appear in the light of these similarities very precious in order to rebuild an itinerary of the shroud during the obscure centuries preceding its appearance in Europe. It would thus be possible to understand why there are so numerous and widespread references to the existence of an image of Christ on a cloth. In this regard, the testimonies concerning the so-called Edessa image are particularly interesting. Edessa was a city of ancient Armenia, subsequently called Urfa and now Sanli Urfa, in southeastern Turkey. A third of the population of Sanli Urfa was Christian at the end of the 19th century, while today Christians are totally absent. The Edessa image was an ancient relic, very venerated, that belonged from immemorial time to the Orthodox Melkite Church. Historian John Wilson claimed and motivated the identification of the Edessa image with the shroud, which was folded in order to show only the face. In the important museum complex of the very city of Sanli Urfa, there is a mosaic of Christ's face, 6th century, which bears a very strong resemblance to the small detailed depiction of the face of Christ on the icon of the saints Sergius and Bacchus, 6th century. This is the enlarged. Coming from the monastery of Santa Caterina at Mount Sinai, which is preserved at the Museum of Western and Eastern Art of Kiev in Ukraine. Both of these depictions show traits inspired by the shroud. Numerous literary testimonies refer to a face of Christ imprinted on a cloth and carried by a disciple of Jesus to King Abgar of Edessa. In St. Caterina Monastery on Mount Sinai, there is a 10th century icon coming from Constantinople, which was presumably made on commission by the emperor. Originally, the two parts of this icon were supposed to be two doors of a reclosable triptych. The central part could include a reproduction of the mandilion of the same dimension of the one that was preserved for centuries in the Basilica of San Silvestro in Capite in Rome, currently in the sacristy of the Sistine Chapel. We have news of it since 17, thanks. Of the same dimension is the image that is preserved in San Bartolomeo of the Armenians in Genoa, 13th, 14th century. Both the images claim to be the true Edessan image. They are paintings on canvas fixed to a wooden panel that has the same format compatible with the missing central part of the triptych. The hypothesis is more than plausible. Indeed, the Sinai icon is assembled on a framework which keeps together the two wings. This is clear from the fact that there is a clear cut in the middle which is not due to a time accident. In the upper part, on the left, a saint is depicted, identifiable as Thaddeus. It is likely that this saint is not only one of the 72 disciples, but one of the 12, the apostle Judas Thaddeus. In fact, he is sitting on the same chair of an emperor, so he's the apostle. In the upper right side, King Abgar is represented with the facial features of Emperor Constantine VII. The sign depicted on the left has a face similar to that of the personage who, on the right, hands over the mandilion to King Abgar. The juxtaposition, it is interesting. Judas Thaddeus, in fact, is on the same level as Abgar and sits on a similar chair to highlight the equal dignity and a certain continuity of the pictorial text, as if to say that there is a sort of connection between the saint and the handover of the mandilion to Abgar, due to the knowledge of texts and oral tradition, we related the two personages. The pictorial analysis of the icon tends to justify this hypothesis. A strong testimony in favor of the identification of this image with the shroud was discovered by historian Gino Zaninotto, the Codex Vossianus Latinus Q69, preserved in the Rijksuniversiteit of Leiden, Netherlands. It is a 10th century manuscript that refers to a prior original Syrian text that dates back to before the 8th century, a period in which it was translated into Latin by the Archiater Smyra. According to the manuscript, while answering Abgar's letter, Jesus writes, "If you wish to look at my appearance as it is physically, I send you this sheet on which you will be able to see not only my face portrait, but you will be able to look at the form of my whole body divinely transfigured." The text continues further and on and states, "The mediator between God and man, in order to completely satisfy the king, lay down with the whole body on a sheet as white as snow, and then happened something wonderful to see and to hear. The glorious image of the face of the Lord, as well as the most noble form of his body, to divine virtue, transformed suddenly on the sheet. In this way, to those who have not seen the Lord come physically, it is enough to see him, the transfiguration produced on the sheet. Still uncorrupted, despite its ancientness, the sheet is in Mesopotamia of Syria, in the city of Edessa, in a room of the major church. During the year, on the occasion of the most important festivity of the Lord Savior, among hymns, psalms, and special canticles, the cloth is pulled out of a golden casket and venerated with great reverence by all the people." An important turning point in the history of the Mandilion occurs in the years 943-94. The fame of the precious image made it very yearned for. When Byzantine Emperor Romanus II Lecapenus in 943 wanted to take possession of it, he sent the army under the command of Armenian General Ioannis Kurkuas. Some interesting Islamic sources report both the permanence of the image in Edessa and the bargaining to give it to Byzantium, as well as the pathway to transfer it into the capital of the empire. The image of Edessa, considered the mindil, that is the handkerchief of the prophet Jesus, according to Islamic sources, was transported to Ruha, Arabic name of Edessa, at the beginning of the 7th century AD, after being kept in Ephesus, Damascus, and Antioch. You know, in Ephesus was living the Virgin with John, so it is important, this Islamic source, that put the presence of the shroud in Ephesus. In the 13th century, historian Ali ibn al-Athir, in his work The Complete History, wrote, "The Emperor of Christians addressed to the Caliph al-Muttaqi a request to hand over of the handkerchief with which Christ, he asserted, had dried his face and on which his image was imprinted, which was in the district of Rua. The splendid shrine which contained the precious effigy came to Constantinople on the evening of August 15, 1944, the feast of the Dormition of the Virgin, surrounded by a triumphal reception. The scene of the solemn arrival of the Mandilion in Constantinople is represented in the Skilitz Codex. It is an illustrated manuscript which reports the synopsis of the history of Johannes Skilitzes, covering a time period ranging from the death of the Byzantine Emperor Nicephorus I in 811 to the deposition of Michael IV in 1057. The manuscript was certainly written in Sicily in 12th century and is currently kept at the Biblioteca Nacional de España in Madrid. It is the only illustrated manuscript of a Greek chronicle that came to us and includes 574 miniatures. In reality, in the first time it was presented in a conference, it was in black and white, and it seemed a long cloth, all the shroud, but now in color we can distinguish that there is the Mandilion small, and this is only a purple cloth to sustain the Mandilion. So honestly, it is not a proof that the Mandilion is long, but we have other proofs. Another important discovery by historian Gino Zaninotto, also in favor of the identification of the Edessa image with the shroud, is the Codex Vatican Gricus 511, which dates back to the 10th century. It contains the oration of Gregory, Archidiacon and Referendarius of the Greek Church of Constantinople, Hagia Sophia. It describes the Edessa image as a figure not restricted to the face alone. In Gregory's sermon, after a scrupulous list of colors commonly used to draw the faces of the icons, the author claims that this image of Edessa, which he is describing, has not been produced with an artificial color since it is only splendor. The reliquary that contained the Mandilion could have been opened during his long stay in Constantinople from 944 to 1204. In this way, it was possible to see not only the face of Jesus, but all his body with the signs of the Passion. The cloth called a tetradiplon, folded in four, should therefore have been partially unfolded. All this could justify the emergence during the 12th century of a new iconic type called in the West Imago Pietatis. This new type depicts the dead Christ standing upright. In the East, this iconographic type is known by the denomination of Acra Tapinosis, Great Humiliation, and E Apokatalosis, deposition. In this iconographic type, Christ is depicted dead, but in a standing position with his arms crossed and his head reclined on his right. Subsequently, the representation of the dead Christ is accompanied by the presence of a structure similar to a grave, oddly resembling a well, from which it appears to emerge. Another iconographic novelty that appears in the same period is the representation of the dead crucified with his reclining head. In fact, in the representation of the crucifixion, there is the passage from Christ still alive, with his eyes wide open, with no sign of suffering, often dressed in colobion, a purple tunic, and crowned. This is in the period precedent the arrival of the shroud in Constantinople. So we are, for example, 8th century, Christ alive with the tunic. But something changed, and we changed to the dead Christ, wounded, with his eyes closed and his head reclined towards his right in a contorted position almost to outline a curve. In addition, it also appears the depiction of Christ deposed from the cross, lying on the funeral sheet called Epitaphios, mainly embroidered on liturgical veils. In the same period, many frescoes appear in the Byzantine churches depicting Christ lying on a shroud with crossed arms in the scene of the deposition, surrounded by evangelical personages referring to the same episode, Mary, John, Joseph of Arimathea, Nicodemus, and the pious women. The peculiarity of this representation makes plausible the hypothesis of a progressive discovery of the mandilion, which reveals itself in its true nature, a cloth with a whole image of the dead Christ and not just of the face. The aforementioned disclosure of the mandilion, also called the rakos tetradiplon, finds confirmation in the research, in the studies, and in the measurements directly made on the shroud. The physicist John Jackson, in 1978, during the research of the Shroud Turin Research Project, noticed on the shroud the existence of folds, like this. Later highlighted by photographs in raking light, in the 90s he assumed that the folds could derive from the use of a gimmick used to lift the mandilion shroud so that the entire frontal figure was progressively visible. The existence of machinery and mechanical devices in the cities of Constantinople is known. It cannot therefore seem unlikely the hypothesis that such a device could be used to expose the mandilion to the faithful. The existence of the Magnaura throne, work of the talent of Emperor Constantine VII Porphyrogenitus, further reinforces this thesis. In the sacred imperial palace, which included barracks, offices, and about 20 churches, the main rooms of representation, called the Triconcas, Chrysotriclinos, literally golden bed, and Magnaura, a huge and gorgeous environment giving the name to all the immense palace, played a key role. They were especially designed to impress visitors and highlight the emperor's sacredness. To achieve this goal, machines were also used to move from the bottom of the room or to lift the throne of the emperor. The fact that he remained motionless and impassive in front of the ambassadors asking for a hearing was considered an essential element to demonstrate the sacredness of his power. The scenery surrounding every emperor's public appearance was made even more impressive by the presence of golden automata that moved through the presence of hydraulic pumps not visible by the public. The throne, symbolically personification of the Solomonic wisdom, was located in the central apse. An Italian ambassador, Liutprand of Cremona, who went to Constantinople in 948 and 966, tells in his work Antapodosis that he had seen two enormous golden lions roaring with their wide open mouths on the sides of the throne, moving their tongue and streaking the floor with their tail. Regarding the throne movement, Liutprando writes, the throne of the emperor was built with skill in such a way that at one instant it was low, then higher, and quickly it appeared most lofty. Those prostrated for a third time in adoration before the emperor, I lifted my head, and the person whom earlier I had seen sitting, elevated to a modest degree above the ground, I suddenly appeared wearing different clothes and sitting almost level with the ceiling of the mansion. The throne was perhaps lifted by virtue of the mechanism thanks to which the beam of the presses are usually lifted. All this was not considered a useless waste of money, as it was intended to demonstrate to the barbarian population and to the potential enemies the intellectual and the technological superiority of the empire. Was there Perhaps such a mechanism to display the Mandelian shroud with equal authoritativeness. Wilson argues that a confirmation of the possible exhibition of the Mandelian raised from a reliquary can be inferred from the observation of a miniature present in a Georgian manuscript of 1054. It is the Alaverdi Tetravangelion, preserved at the Institute of Manuscripts of Georgian Academy of Science of Tbilisi. It includes the four Gospels and the story of the image brought to King Abgar. It was realized shortly after the returning to Georgia by King Bagrat IV, who had remained in Constantinople in the previous 3 years. In the miniature, it is possible to see a golden drape that appears rise from a reliquary and on it the Mandelion decorated with red crosses. The weekly exhibition of the shroud during his stay in Constantinople is attested by the testimony of the Crusader knight Robert de Clary. You know the story, we can not read all the witness of Robert de Clary. This testimony seems to significantly strengthen Jackson's thesis. Robert de Clary also saw in the chapel of St. Mary de Pharos the reliquary of the Mandelion, which at that moment could be empty, as the shroud was exposed at Balakerne. The shroud seen by Robert de Clary disappears mysteriously from Constantinople. The depiction of the Man of Sorrows that spread in Constantinople at the time of a well-known presence of this image find therefore confirmation in the literary sources of their possible shroud origin. The observation of the similarity with the Man of the Shroud, two Roman images present in the Basilica of Holy Cross in Jerusalem and the fourth crowned martyrs, suggested the deepening of the relationship between the sacred linen and the new depiction of the suffering Christ, Christus patient. We have seen originate in Constantinople in the period coinciding with the established presence of this image. The two Roman images belong to the iconographic type we have previously described and which chase the names of Imago Pietatis. In the Roman Basilica of Holy Cross in Jerusalem, following a donation by Prince of Taranto Raimondello del Balzo Orsini, there is a Byzantine mosaic icon depicting the Man of Sorrows. It is a masterpiece of Constantinopolitan mosaic art from the beginning of the 14th century. The figure of Christ is represented at the head of the bust with the crossed hands and the reclined head, while on the bottom stands the cross with the canonical Byzantine inscription, the King of Glory. This image, which came to Rome already surrounded by the aura of a taumaturgical image, know a great fame. By linking to the tradition of an apparition of dead Christ to Gregory the Great during the celebration of the Mass, the iconographic motif of the Man of Sorrow experienced an extraordinary spread through the Catholic Church. A fresco in the Church of the Four Crowned Martyrs in Rome just opposes an Imago Pietatis with the representation of the funeral sheet of Christ held by the two angels. On this sheet there are figures of leaves while the body of Christ is covered with sores. The fresco dates back to the 14th century and assumes some indirect knowledge of the shroud. Yes, the time is finished. Yes, maybe in the evening we can continue with somebody interested, because I have also other interesting pictures to show.
Thank you.
Okay?
Thank you. Sorry, we just ran out of time.
Okay.
So.